This programming is sponsored by the Bayou Theater at the University of Houston Clear Lake, announcing their new season, featuring a variety of music, dance, theater, and comedy performances. Tickets at uhcl.universitytickets.com.
I see you.
He was a prominent African-American businessman, a philanthropist who helped finance much of the civil rights movement. And like many narratives of black historical figures, we recognize their accomplishment, acknowledge their achievement. But how come when we speak of the late millionaire Norris Herndon, his sexual orientation was kept secret to the public? Would this be the reason why his story remained unknown for decades?
There's more to the question, right? Because it actually maybe evokes emotion. Right? That it's like, wow, why is it that it's not talked about?
I'm Eddie Robinson, and stay tuned as we take a closer look at the mystery behind the black gay millionaire that nobody knows. Join us for a candid chat about Norris Herndon with writer, columnist for the Georgia Voice, Ryan Lee, and historian Pamela Flores. Oh yeah, I feel you. We hear you. I see you. You're listening to I See You. I'm Eddie Robinson. He was a part of the Atlanta elite, a prominent African-American businessman who picked up an MBA from Harvard. He was a philanthropist, even a major financier of the civil rights movement. He was also gay. You can't help but wonder if that might have been the reason why so many people didn't know about him. His name was Norris Herndon, the second president of the Atlanta Life Insurance Company, which was founded by his father, Alonzo Herndon, who died in 1927 in Atlanta. Norris's father, Alonzo, was born into slavery and a sharecropper in rural Georgia, but yet founded Atlanta Life in the year 1905 and ended up thriving to become one of the first African-American millionaires in the United States, first achieving success by owning and operating some three large barber shops in Atlanta that prominently served white customers. But his only child, Norris, will be the focus of this episode of ICU. And I'm so excited to connect with a writer who also felt compelled to learn and study more about this man, a man who remains unknown, and recently penned a comprehensive article about him in the digital publication The Reckoning. Please join me in welcoming to ICU with Eddie Robinson, writer, columnist, Ryan Lee. Ryan, thanks so much for joining us virtually from Atlanta.
Thanks for having me, Eddie. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I absolutely, Ryan, had no idea who this man was. And I'm approaching a half century in age myself, right? Mm-hmm. Surrounded by family members growing up who were a part of the civil rights movement in Mississippi. Though I wasn't alive, you know, when the civil rights movement started, of course, but it's also surprising to think that not many Atlanta residents knew who this man was, right?
Yeah, I mean, I've spoken with Atlanta natives who said they had no idea. I've spoken with Morris Brown alumni, you know, which is right across the street from the Herndon home, and the Herndon, the family had a very instrumental role in all of the HBCUs, but particularly Morris Brown. But folks who, you know, traversed that campus and had no clue about the family story.
Yeah, and I'll tell you quite honestly, you know, it was from my Facebook feed, you know, of a gay digital video of someone mentioning his name in a Did You Know presentation. You know, that and the video was talking about a gay man who had been responsible for financing much of the civil rights movement. I mean, how did you get caught up into this story? You know, were you assigned to it? Did you have a vested interest in it yourself? Why was this story so important to you, and what led you to want to study and cover the story, which I love the title, The Black Gay Millionaire That Nobody Knows? That's the name of the article. It's great.
No, I appreciate it. I've had a long interest in Norris. I first learned about him in about 2004. It was about 2 years after the book on the Herndons was published by Carol Merritt. And there was a Black Human Rights Campaign Atlanta board member who approached me and was like, hey, have you ever heard of Norris Herndon? You know, I went to go tour the family home and they were pretty open about him being gay. And, you know, it's in the book that he was gay. So that was my first time getting it on my radar. And then I went to go visit the home and was fascinated. The publication that I was working for at the time wasn't interested in that story. And then the Herndon home got into some financial issues, the organization that runs it. And so then we ran a story on that. And Ronald Moore, the gentleman who originally told me about the Herndons, he was very upset that, you know, we hadn't covered, you know, the story prior to, and now it gets in trouble. So that always stung because I knew that that was absolutely true, that, you know, we hadn't covered the basic story, but now we've covered the scandal. And so I've always wanted to revisit that basic story. And then I live catty corner to the Herndon home, so I can, you know, I step outside my front door and I can see their backyard. And so it's always been somewhat enchanting to imagine, you know, the parties that would go on up there and things like that. And so I've always had that curiosity about sort of the Herndon spirit.
Why do you think, Ryan, there is little to hardly any confirmed accounts and information about the Herndon family?
I think that part of it is, you know, Norris's secrecy, and secrecy is kind of a pejorative word. It makes it sound like, you know, there's some malintent there, but just his privacy, his devout privacy and reclusion from the world. As I was in this process and somewhat frustrated by the lack of information out there, you had to stop and realize, well, this is what happens when, you know, you spend your whole life protecting folks knowing about you, then it's no surprise that once you're gone, then a lot of folks don't know about you. So that's one, just an extension of the family's privacy. Two is the lack of a lineage. Norris was Alonzo's only son, and Norris had no children. And so unlike other families here in Atlanta, whether it be the King children or John Wesley Dobbs children who would go on to become the first Black mayor of Atlanta and things like that, there's been folks left behind to make sure that certain stories are protected. And there hasn't been anybody left behind to make sure that the Herndon's story is protected. And then thirdly, and this was probably the most disheartening aspect of the story that I found, was that Norris, understanding that he didn't have any heirs, prior to his death, he created the Alonzo F. and Norris B. Herndon Foundation. And that foundation inherited his wealth and was dedicated to preserving both the home, Atlanta Life Insurance, the company, and just continuing to help the community. And just at the glance that I was able to take, that foundation has failed miserably on all three of those fronts, and most notably in making sure that the Herndon story is known and preserved.
It's ICU. I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're chatting with Ryan Lee. He's a writer based in Atlanta for the Georgia Voice. He wrote an article a few months back for the digital website The Reckoning about the Black millionaire Norris Herndon, who died in the late 70s. But not many people knew that he financed much of the civil rights movement, and he was gay. You know, as you were writing this article, Ryan, what was it that you still find surprising or even quite compelling or shocking about Norris Herndon and his family? Or perhaps it was, you know, his father or his family in general. You know, as you did your research and you did your examination, you know, what surprised you the most about what you uncovered?
The idea probably that he was hiding, or, you know, like, I mean, that is the first impression that you would get just hearing from the story, is that he kind of walled himself off and kind of hid from the world, and, you know, took being on the down low to the extreme. And so I write in the piece about how it's hard to recognize any heroism in that, because it feels like he withdrew from society rather than either participate or try to move it forward. But just getting immersed in that time and the pressures that he was under from his family and from the conventions of mid-century America back in the 20th century, many things were expected of him for how he was supposed to live his life. And the way that he declined to go by other people's script, and the way that he chose to find his own path, turned out to be more inspiring than I originally perceived from my basic outline of the story.
Yeah, and it sounds like Norris struggled with being gay, or at least, you know, that's what, you know, historians and those who had been familiar with him characterized him as, you know, trying to live up to the expectations set forth by his father and society as a whole back in that era. I mean, here I am as a man who had only come out to my mom and dad in 2007, and it was over the phone. You know, even at that, I was so nervous. It took my best friend really to help provide me with the support that I needed, right, to get through that ordeal. I can only imagine living in this era, what it could have been like, you know, struggling with all of this and the pressures from his father. And from what I gathered after reading your article, that, you know, his father really wanted him to be active, perhaps even in sports, so that helped him with his academia at Harvard, because I think he wrote a letter or something saying that he was alone, he was lonely at Harvard. I mean, the pressures of being gay and being Black in the early 1900s, you know, that had to have been intense, right?
Oh, absolutely. And one interesting thing is that he wasn't closeted in the sense that we may think of that word contemporaneously and during his time. His parents clearly knew about it. His father had some objections to it, but it wasn't a gratuitous homophobia that he encountered. His father was probably about as good as one could be, you know, in the early 1900s on that issue. Obviously disappointed in terms of legacy and expectations and things like that, but doesn't seem to be any a direct confrontation between the two of them regarding the propriety of, you know, him enjoying men's company or things like that. His mother died before he had a true chance to, you know, form that part of his identity, but, you know, she probably knew. And then most surprisingly, that all his peers knew. Everyone knew that, you know, Norris had some sweetness, and I think it speaks back to that time in Black communities where folks knew, you know, that there were, you know, certain uncles and certain neighbors who had that sweetness, and they were still part of the community, and, you know, there were limitations on how much they could express that, but there was an awareness of that sort of queerness.
That's fascinating, because even in that era, you would think that, especially your father, you know, he would be very, very upset and, you know, just really disowning him perhaps on some level, but it was not that he accepted it, right? You know, give us some a bit more insight as to Norris's relationship with his father, because I did get the gist that I remember, you know, Norris complaining about him being lonely at Harvard, but his father would write and tell him, go to church, serve the Lord, and then you won't get lonesome. Right. And you know what, Ryan? I mean, that's taken exactly out of the pages of Eddie Robinson's parental guidance that I received when I lived in Minnesota. Both my mom and dad would always push me to attend church. You know, join the choir, stay busy, be active in the Lord's house. But it was really quite fascinating to read that about Norris and his relationship with his own father. Mm-hmm. And he wasn't, like you said, it wasn't hardcore and stern and, like, you know, disowning, we don't want to talk to you again. But they wanted to sort of encourage him to do something else, and that more than likely hurt his mentality, Norris.
Yeah, they had a complicated relationship. Norris was closest with his mother, Adrienne. He sort of took after her. She was a renowned actress and lover of the arts and things like that, and so he had developed that affinity throughout childhood and things like that. Then she died when he was 12 years old, so it left Alonzo and Norris by themselves for a little bit until Alonzo remarried, and thankfully his new wife was very supportive and loving of Norris, and so whatever friction or alienation might have occurred between father and son didn't blow out of proportion. I think mainly they were from two different generations of Black masculinity. You know, I mean, Alonzo was, you know, born on a plantation and sold grease and picked cotton and did everything with his hands and built a fortune out of nothing. And then by the time, you know, Norris came along, you know, they were a family of substantial means. And so Norris's childhood was a lot different a lot more luxurious and leisurely and just wasn't as industrious. And I think a lot of men of Alonzo's generations, you know, it's common today, you know, men always think that the new generation is soft. That's right. And so they had those types of conflicts. But Alonzo clearly had tremendous affection for his son. He brought him to the Niagara Movement, the planning sessions for that, which would later become the NAACP. You know, it was important for his son to be there. And then most importantly, rather than disowning him, he set up everything so that Norris would continue Atlanta life, that he would inherit the presidency, inherit Alonzo's fortune and things like that. And I think that Atlanta life was as much Alonzo's child as Norris, and Alonzo trusted Norris to shepherd that child once he was gone.
Coming up, we'll continue our chat with writer Ryan Lee as we learn a bit more about the late Norris Herndon and find out why much of his story remained untold for so long. And then later, we'll connect with historian Pamela Flores, who'll share details as to what it was like for the Herndon family while they lived in a beautiful two-story mansion completed in 1910. The Atlanta House is now a museum and National Historic Landmark. But what is the current condition of the home? Find out as ICU with Eddie Robinson returns in just a moment. If you're enjoying this program, please be sure to subscribe to our podcast, ICU with Eddie Robinson. You can hear all the past episodes and be notified when new episodes are released. Also, please take a minute to give us a review or comment. We love getting feedback from our listeners. It's ICU. I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're speaking with columnist Ryan Lee. He's a writer based in Atlanta for the Georgia Voice. He recently penned an article about the black millionaire Norris Herndon for The Reckoning, a digital website platform that highlights unique stories of the black LGBTQ community. You know, Ryan, Norris and his family had a light-complexioned skin. As African Americans, and they could each pass for Caucasian, easily blending into Atlanta's white community. And you know, it just hits me. You know, back in Mississippi, back in the day, my late grandfather, who is light skinned as well, who was light skinned. I mean, he's passed away, but he had 12 brothers, 8 of which served in World War II. After being in the military, 3 of the brothers obtained a small business loan to form a dry cleaning establishment. But that money, you know, those loans that they received certainly wouldn't have materialized had it not been for their skin color, you know, right? As they were able to pass for white. In the 60s, during the Civil Rights Movement, their dry cleaning establishment served as really one of the most active gathering places for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee members, or SNCC workers. My grandfather would allow them to use telephones and if they needed transportation and when necessary to avoid tax from the Ku Klux Klan, you know, they could hide among the racks of the clean clothes. And the cleaners, you know, really sort of escaped being bombed in Macomb, Mississippi, because my grandfather, along with his brothers, would take turns guarding the business. And again, it was their light skin color that helped guide them and protect them, in essence, you know, from danger of being arrested. But Norris's skin color, it was also something how he wanted to be acknowledged a certain way, right? I mean, I think that I read something about he didn't necessarily want to be called black, but he wanted to be called colored.
Right.
What was going on there?
He made that statement in 1977, which was the last year of his life. So, you know, he's an older gentleman, and I think that just reflects more just the conservatism of language things like that, rather than any aversion to solidarity with blacks. An equivalent for LGBT listeners would be, you know, there are some, you know, older queer folks who don't call themselves LGBT because, you know, that's not who, you know, they da-da-da. So I think it's that kind of thing. While all of them were light, Norris probably couldn't pass for white only because of his parents. All of the black elite in Atlanta during that time was pretty high yellow. It's just a nature of privilege that you speak of, and the opportunity and the ease with which the white establishment welcomed folks, but it didn't mean that they were immune to the discrimination. Adrienne was repeatedly denied roles once it was discovered that she was Black, and she wasn't trying to hide that she was Black, but, you know, folks assumed that she was white, and then when she would let them know, no, I'm Black, then she was denied acting roles and things like that. So she suffered that during the 1906 race riots. One of Alonzo's barber, an employee of one of his barbershops, was murdered during those riots, and Norris had to flee to Philadelphia for safety for about a year. So the family certainly felt the implications of being Black. But the reason why I said that Norris couldn't pass is because even as high yellow as he was, and even if he could have passed, his parents had set the tone already that, no, we're not passers. Alonzo was deeply committed to the Niagara Movement and NAACP and HBCUs and things like that. And so by the time Norris came along, no matter how high his complexion, I think he understood he was Black through and through. And his commitment to the Black community certainly, despite that, throughout his years.
Sure. It's I See You. I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're speaking with Ryan Lee. He's the writer of an article penned on the life of Norris Herndon, and it's on thereckoningmag.com. Describe for us, Ryan, this family thrived, bankrolling all over the place in a time and an era, you know, where Blacks really, you know, were transforming their own world, you know, post-slavery, becoming a force to be reckoned with. Blacks experienced phenomenal wealth and prestige. And yet today, there's an element of uncertainty, the aesthetic, right? The look of portions of the community, you know, where, for instance, Herndon Stadium, it's now, you know, as what you call it, an urban ruin, you know, a site once cherished during the 1996 Atlanta Olympics. And even for a number of HBCU classic football games, it's now rife with graffiti, you know, overgrown lawn. You know, it's not very appealing. You know, it even sounds, you know, from your description in your article, that, you know, the Herndon home, which I believe was declared a National Historic Landmark back in 2000, you know, it's surviving gentrification, you know, where it sits right now. But perhaps, you know, there's uncertainty for the plot of land it rests on, you know, and the upkeep of the mansion itself. You know, what's your take on the fate of, you know, this facility, this mansion, perhaps any other structures with Herndon name attached to it in Atlanta?
I think without significant awareness of the Herndon story, I'm very worried about the fate of the Herndon home. Atlanta is not a city that traditionally has an affinity for history in terms of architecture and things like that. We're quick to bulldoze a Black church for a football parking lot, you know, kind of thing. That's the kind of attitude that has been predominant throughout Atlanta development in the past half century. And so it's certainly susceptible to that. You look at Herndon Stadium, and the fate of Herndon Stadium alone is terrifying, because it could still be repurposed into something very beautiful. It's a beautiful structure, beautiful space, you know, that could be turned into a youth league, you know, facility or something like that. But it's just empty and idle, and you just wonder, what is the, you know, plan? You know, we can't let this, you know, just crumble. Herndon Home is about half a block away from that, and it's in pristine condition now. You know, it's a very nicely contained home, but there is no one there monitoring it for weeks on end, and throughout the years it has been, you know, susceptible to burglaries and break-ins and things like that. And right across the street is the former home of Grace Counts Hamilton, which is another Black luminary from back in the day, and her home is in rubble. A dilapidated and abandoned mansion. And that the Herndon home has been able to be preserved thus far is very inspiring. But there are all kinds of signs that it takes very little for something that was once quite a gem to disintegrate into rubble.
It's I See You. I'm Eddie Robinson. We'll speak more with writer Ryan Lee later in the show, but we also wanted to go deeper and learn a bit more about Norris Herndon and connect with one of the first historians who had written about him, Pamela Flores. She, too, is based in Atlanta and was conducting research on the Herndon family while at Georgia State University. Pamela, thanks so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to be a part of ICU with Eddie Robinson.
Thank you for the invitation.
Yeah. Why do you think there is little to hardly any confirmed accounts and information about the Herndon family?
Well, my personal opinion is that certainly it's not a legacy that at the time, let's just call the powers that be in the city of Atlanta, would have wanted everyone else to be inspired by those sort of ambitions that were achieved by both of those gentlemen in their respective time period at the helm of the company that still exists today.
And those powers that be, do you know if there was any, you know, specifically any specific reason as to why they didn't want this information to be known earlier? I mean, I certainly didn't know anything about Norris Herndon.
I would say it's pretty much the same situation that we're in at the turn of this century, right? Even though we're already in the second decade of it. But, of course, this was coming out of Reconstruction, right? So what was achieved by the dad,
Alonzo,
during that time period certainly was not something that the white aristocracy, right, of the city, of the town, would have wanted more people to be inspired and to do that. So certainly they were muted in their respective ways.
Sure.
So again, totally. It's just a personal opinion just on reflecting on what I'm experiencing now in this time period, and then reading firsthand sources of what was happening in that time period, because the Atlanta race riots were 1906, right? I mean, that was the same time period that house was getting permitted to be built. And the house that I'm mentioning is the museum that is their standing legacy, right? That's the bricks and mortar of their legacy.
Wow, that's fascinating. And talk to us about the history of the Herndon home, this immaculate two-story, 15-room mansion that had been built by local Black craftsmen, as I understand it, right?
That's correct. So the Herndon family moved in January of 1910, and that was Norris. At that age, I guess he would have been maybe about 12, because his mother, his birth mother, you know, she passed away when he was 12, and it was like they moved in, had that certificate of occupancy in January, and her, I think it's the wake, I guess, it was in April that same year. So she really didn't get to fully enjoy the house that she designed herself. But it's said that from their many trips abroad, that they would go on steamboats, you know, going that way across the Atlantic, that when they were in their expeditions of Europe, that they would come up with these concepts and ideas of how they would design, you know, their massive home. The detail in what Mr. Herndon decided to do, even down to the brick, right? Like there was a local brickman who was a segregationist, because this white boy literally used convict, quote unquote, labor
to leasing.
Fund his, and it's called, it was called Chattahoochee Brick Company, and the man's name was James English, who was a mayor, who he would use public policy to lock up and put in chains, literally, the chain gang. People couldn't pay off their debt. They couldn't go to jail. But every Friday after they got off their real job, they'd go and sign in to, you know, pay that debt off. So he refused to buy local brick and bought it from a brick house up in Ohio that a Black man owned.
Awesome.
And he incorporated that into the exterior of his house. So, you know, the Black artisans that you talk about, I mean, you should see the woodwork in this home over 100 years later, immaculate, like the precision of everything in the home, right? The way that it's still standing today after little love over the years, you know, because legacy gets forgotten, and it's literally just sitting there in, let's just call it a graveyard of another historical landmark, right? The Morris Brown campus. So certainly it's a diamond in the rough, and it's crazy because it's referenced as Diamond Hill. It's actually the highest sea level in Atlanta. Like the viewpoint from that particular hill is the highest natural elevation in the city of Atlanta boundaries, period. And the reason why that land was even given over to the bishops of the AME Church, they were deeded that land supposedly because of where the railroad track was, right? The railroad track right there was confiscated by Union soldiers, and the Confederates, you know, lost the war supposedly, right? So it's tarnished land, right? So they said, here, we'll let you bishops have it. You decide to do what you want to do. But again, kind of like going back to the legacy with all of the AUC, right? That there were colorisms even then stipulated into the HBCU schools, right? Spelman, for instance, if you didn't pass the brown paper bag test, you weren't going to that school to get educated, to learn to read and write. And especially, you know, not a woman. So for the way in which the Morris Brown campus, which is where his first wife, the school teacher, Adrian, right? You know, she would do theater and in the design of, you know, going back to the question of the house, she literally created a theater on the rooftop where they would have plays and fundraisers. And of course, this was like the black aristocracy of Atlanta. This is where it was happening at, right? But just if you go back to the origins of Mr. Herndon Sr., it's like no one would have fathomed that an 8-year-old child would walk from, you know, his origins and how those are all the way to what was the capital city following a telegram pole. You know, and it's like the picture of his child when I would say, I think there's a famous picture of Norris amongst many, many, many intellectuals. It included like Dubois and John Hope and others, that it was like the founding of the Niagara movement, right? Which is now the NAACP.
Awesome.
It's an interest in history. And I would say the home was so well thought out in every detail that in their historical record, Mrs. Herndon, first wife, right? She literally has receipts of where about in Paris, France, she bought the pink silk wallpaper that is the paneling that is in the piano room.
Jeez.
Like, she left where you can go get the replacement because of how she knew their legacy. Like, she was, like her husband, a mulatto woman. She came from Savannah. And she, like her husband, you know, were daughters of women that were in bondage, and their daddy was the planter in both cases, you know? So they had that commonality, which is why when they would go to Europe, they could pass.
Sure.
And be in those spaces and learn, you know.
Because of their skin color.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Coming up, we take a closer look at why many of these properties and housing structures that carry the Herndon name today have been neglected for some time now, and what some are calling urban ruin. Are these abandoned areas becoming a hunting ground for real estate opportunists and land grabs? What must be done to preserve the rich histories and legacies of ancestors? Are conservancies, local and regional area commissions, doing their part? And who's responsible for sustaining all of it? We explore those questions and more with our guests, historian Pamela Flores and writer Ryan Lee, when ICU with Eddie Robinson returns in just a moment. If you're enjoying this program, please be sure to subscribe to our podcast, ICU with Eddie Robinson. You can hear all the past episodes and be notified when new episodes are released. Also, please take a minute to give us a review or comment. We love getting feedback from our listeners. You're listening to ICU. I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're exploring the life of a not-so-well-known civil rights activist who died back in 1977 named Norris Herndon, a gay black financier of the civil rights movement. Earlier, we spoke with writer Ryan Lee, who penned a recent comprehensive article on him for TheReckoning.com. And we'll circle back to Ryan later this segment, but for now, let's continue our chat with Pamela Flores. She was one of the first historians to conduct research on Norris Herndon and his family. ICU did try to reach out and speak with a representative from the Herndon Foundation based in Atlanta, but we received no response prior to airtime. Pamela, as you've done your research and examination, you know, perhaps over a decade ago, what has still surprised you the most about what you've uncovered and revealed about this family?
You know, I don't want to seem like I'm saddened by the situation, but when, you know, it's like I am asked to think about it, it is sad that it's like, there's more to the question, right? Because it actually maybe evokes emotion, right? That it's like, wow, why is it that it's not talked about, you know? And it's like, obviously my first response to that initial question is because they don't want anybody to replicate that, obviously. That would totally, totally topple the status quo, right? Like ruffle feathers in ways that perhaps, you know, nowadays, most people haven't been comfortable in doing.
Interesting.
Until recently, right? So,
can you describe for us what really is happening today in 2022 with that which is associated with the Herndon name as it relates to the stadium, its upkeep, perhaps? Writer Ryan Lee spoke earlier in this episode and wrote an article about how he's called it an urban ruin, how the name has been attached to the Herndon Homes, the housing project. You know, what's going on with the politic of what you really think is happening right now in 2022 as it relates to the Herndon name?
Well, I do believe that just like in all cases across the country, that it's a land grab again, right? Mm-hmm. It's like it's all a land grab. If we look at the definition of the word gentrification, it is not about black and white. It is about wealth and no wealth. And in that, you know, the African-American population seems to look at Atlanta as the black Mecca, right? It is a place to invest, to go back to, you know, because obviously there was a time in history that people migrated, you know, during the Langston Hughes eras and the Roaring 20s. And like, we're talking 100 years ago, and it's crazy because, you know, history does repeat itself. But certainly it's like people are going back and going to the city, but they're contributing to the displacement of people that look like them, you know, sort of with the color green as just being the common denominator in all of it, right? Because there can be things that could have been done. I mean, you can't tell me that stadium that is, you know, the Norris Herndon Stadium, like, that is literally in the shadow of another stadium. You know, I was there before the stadium. I'm there, you know, but before the Super Bowl was actually played there. So it was like I was there before, I was there during, and I'm here after. And it's just like, my goodness, how can a legacy like that be gone so, you know, so soon that it's been eradicated practically from everybody's memory there locally? A lot of the former residents of that Herndon Homes housing project, you know, They didn't even know the namesake, per se, of what that is all about. Like, whose name is that? What did he do? And, you know, there are schools that have been named after him, too, right? But it was like, that was the most notorious one as it relates to recognition with name, because it's not, you know, society has not wanted to uplift those legacies that do inspire others to achieve. And many have, but because most lose sight, you know, it doesn't become about the whole concept of what is Sankofa or reaching back and helping others. And, you know, the whole concept of how minute it may seem that Mr. Herndon would go way to where is the nearest black brick house? Like, I'm not going to go buy this man's over here. I'm going to go way over there. But ironically, that brick actually has like iron deposits in it. So I don't know if it, like, you know, the brickyard actually put the deposits into the bricks. But certainly it's like he went through that effort to go get that stuff from up there to bring it to build his house, and almost like in a position to be like, I will never buy brick from convict labor. James Blackman wrote a book called Slavery by a Different Name. You know, same thing. It was depicted so beautifully in the movie Life, but, you know, these were actual, like, they made specific brick to build these cities and to kind of keep the labor force, right, where they wanted it, but they were still benefiting from all of what was being built around the city. Yet again, we would be the burden bearers, right? We would continue to be the burden bearers. There's no way. So Mr. Herndon was like, I will not participate in that.
It's ICU. I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're speaking with historical scholar Pamela Flores. She's been instrumental as one of the early students over at Georgia State to bring attention to the Herndon family's history. Just curious, in your mind, do you think that some family members try to walk that line of wanting or having the desire to protect and preserve the rich family history versus
dealing with what everybody already knew? I mean, come on, 1955, okay. Ebony,
everyone
a magazine.
Already knew. Yeah,
come
everyone,
on. I mean, like, it was not a secret. It's just
it was not
the
a secret.
Time period was not something that was upheld and uplifted.
Okay. And it's so ironic that he did shut himself off to the public, which in my mind, that's kind of how that history just stopped. You know, we never really heard anything about Norris Herndon.
Right.
And I think that impacted the story to be told, right?
Surely it had to. But, you know, I think that for gentlemen like yourself and Mr. Ryan Lee, right, that yeah. explore the topics and tell the story could bring it to light and perhaps, you know, join forces and preserve that history even more and, like, continue to make more legacies, right? Because Atlanta is also, you know, not just the Black Mecca for entrepreneurship and homeownership just because of, again, the land value of here versus somewhere up north now. I mean, certainly there is a huge LGBT community that is African American descent that could latch onto this history, make it one's own.
Sure, sure. And to think that Norris or anyone from that era, you know, what if they would have had a means to communicate or share with like-minded stories and narratives with individuals like themselves, right? I mean, that would have been explosive, but...
No, surely. I mean, the Atlanta University Center could become an epicenter to make sure that people know this story, right? And it's like that whole mentorship.
Yes.
I mean, like, it can be preserved, but it's like those that are like-minded have to come together to do that.
There you go. What should this story, the history of Norris Herndon, Pamela, what should this story mean to America? As you take into account all that you've unfolded, all that you've revealed, all that you've discovered about the Herndon legacy, are there any lessons that America needs to learn, you know, from this story, from this history? And secondly, maybe, you know, what should Black Americans take away from this story? What should this story mean to them?
All Americans could read about the story and learn from the story, right? But at the end of the day, everyone has to do their part. Let's look back at Mr. Alex Haley and Queen, where it's like her struggle.
Don't listen to him, Queen. It don't matter.
It does matter. It matters to me. It's like half of me missing.
Where could she fit the best, right? You know, and obviously that's from the female's perspective. But if we talk about just the origins of it all,
sure.
right, of why the situations have been, it is because America really doesn't like to look at what it actually has done, right, throughout its existence.
Pamela Flores, looking over your life, your career, and the history of even the Herndon's family and their legacy, what lesson have you learned about yourself?
That if I actually want to see something change, I have to do it myself. I mean, that adage is still very much alive. So I would say that is absolutely it. You have to do it yourself. You can't expect someone else to do anything.
She was one of the earlier students at Georgia State to bring attention to this Herndon family's history, historical scholar Pamela Flores. Thank you so much for being a guest on ICU with Eddie Robinson.
I appreciate the opportunity.
We thank Pamela for her time and insight as it relates to learning more about the Herndon family, and more specifically, Norris Herndon. In this episode of ICU, we continue to understand the notion of bringing attention to this man now, in this day and age especially, as it seemed like his history, his legacy, really, for the most part, had been largely unknown. And I'm almost sure as to the reason behind the mystique centered mostly around the fact that he was gay. Surely those around him, his family members, close known associates, knew that he was indeed gay, but it wasn't made public. We can now highlight this fact and celebrate him and his remarkable story and family even more. We wrap up our conversation here at ICU with Eddie Robinson, with writer and columnist for the LGBTQ plus community's Georgia Voice publication, Ryan Lee. I'm curious, as you were writing this particular article, do you consider yourself to be an activist? Did you have a sense of sort of like making sure that you can come away with really confirming the fact that this man was indeed gay?
Yeah, absolutely. Proving that he was gay was part of the thing, but also proving that he was a big deal, you know, in general, because the folks who don't even know the baseline story, you know, that, you know, his father was a slave who became a millionaire, and they, you know, donated money to the founding of the NAACP. They funded the civil rights movement. There's telegrams back and forth between he and Martin Luther King, and he and Benjamin Mays, and they're just always thanking him for his donations in the oral history projects. You know, everyone's talking about how generous Herndon and Atlanta Life were throughout all their activities. And so people don't even know that. So it was severalfold. And I to start with, yes, I certainly saw activism in my reporting, only because I would ask the sources that I was interviewing, like, hey, what's it going to take for anybody to do anything about this? And they were like, well, it takes stories like this, you know, and people, you know, will learn. And so I understood that my story would be part of that effort to bring attention to and things like that. And so I was very fine with that. And then also I was writing for the publication, The Reckoning. And so, you know, we obviously adhere to journalism principles and tenets and things like that. But I was writing specifically for Black gay men or Black LGBT folks. And I wanted to present them a story that was accurate. You know, I don't want to tell them a fairy tale of this mythical great Black gay man that nobody knows anything about. I've known, you know, the seed of the Herndon story for about 15 years, and I had to, you know, flesh it out within, you know, my understanding of, you know, how much did I know was true, or how much was it, you know, just word of mouth and everything. And so as I was writing it, I did have, there's about three sections to the story. And I think that, like the first section establishes beyond a doubt, these people were big deals in Black history, and they played a huge role in the earliest Black liberation movement and then the mightiest Black liberation movement of the 60s. So establishing that fact, you know, like when researchers try to chart the civil power structure of Atlanta, their efforts were complicated by the existence of a Black hierarchy independent of the white hierarchy. And Herndon was identified as the head of that Black hierarchy. And so again, it's not hyperbole to say what a big deal he was in a Black Atlanta history and Black America history. So I wanted to establish that. And then I did want to confirm his sexual orientation. It was rewarding to find quotes like the one from Irene Dobbs Jackson calling him a sissy, you know, from back in that time, to know that, okay, people really did perceive him like this. And then one of the true gems was finding the letter that one of his visitors wrote to her father. And some of it's coy, or, you know, like she talks about how she visited him and she met Mr. Hubert Johnson, who is the music director of the church, and, you know, the music director of Morse Brown. And, you know, so there's innuendo there, but it just makes you smile and think, like, you know, imagining what type of friendship Norris Herndon and Mr. Johnson had. So those were some of the aims, again, establishing who's a big deal for Black folks in general. And then to establish that, you know, we're pretty confident that he was homosexual. And then finally to ask what can be done to protect his story.
To protect that story and to learn about it. You know, I mean, there is a thin line of wanting or having the desire to protect or preserve the rich family history versus providing a solid, open pathway to the public and ensuring that this history is told, you know, and it has to be acknowledged and the full unadulterated truth must be told. Do you find that there are still perhaps some forces that, you know, still want to really not allow the distraction of his gayness to distract from his accomplishments, the history, the financial role that he played in the civil rights movement? Are there still folks who simply don't want that part of the story be told?
I don't sense that. I think it's more just a victim of sort of civic laziness in terms of, you know, again, the municipal governments have no interest in preserving the legacy. HBCUs who benefited so tremendously from the family don't appear to be doing very much to champion the legacy of the Herndons. LGBT organizations in Atlanta that love to talk about all of the interconnections between LGBT rights and black civil rights, sure, and things like that. They have done nothing for the legacy of Norris Herndon. And then I mentioned in the article, even Atlanta's hip hop moguls who ought to, I really idolize, particularly Alonzo's story of the grit that he had and what he was able to accomplish, should be an inspiration to black entrepreneurs everywhere. And there's no effort on them to know the story, you know, kind of thing. So, you know, it's not necessarily their fault that they weren't told of that story, but again, it's a citywide failure that nobody's picked up the ball to think of this. And then the saddest thing is that any Atlantan today that hears Herndon will think of the Herndon Homes, which was a housing project, and which was, it's just a disgraceful legacy that is the image that is brought to mind by the family's name.
As a writer, and for you as a person, you know, through this article, after writing about Norris Herndon and learning so much about him and his family, and, you know, I'm wondering if you were able to look within and assess who you are as a person today. What lesson, if any, you know, did you take away for yourself?
It was an intimate process, learning his story and spending time, hours and hours, reading all kinds of unrelated stuff with the hopes that, you know, you might find that one thing. But even that unrelated stuff, you know, just gets you a little bit closer to him. And like I said, I live catty corner to him. And so, you know, I am able to step out my front door and just look up to, it's the Herndon home sits on a hill. And so just to look up there and imagine the parties that he might've had and things like that. And so, and there was intimacy on that level. And then his devotion to privacy is something that I empathize with to a great degree. I'm certainly not as much of a recluse as he appears to have been, but I've certainly avoided certain social rituals that I did not want to participate in, or social goals that I don't want to aim for and things like that. And I really admire his fidelity to who he was, and that he was going to experience this world in a way that brought him comfort and satisfaction, regardless of what other people thought he was supposed to be doing.
Fascinating. Writer, columnist, Ryan Lee, thank you so much for being a guest on ICU.
Thanks for having me, Eddie. I've really enjoyed talking with you.
Our team includes technical director Todd Holzlender, producer Laura Burks, editors Mark DiClaudio and John Mitchell Good, sound designer Dave McDermott. ICU is a production of Houston Public Media. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter. And for more updates and episodes, visit our website, iseeushow.org. I'm your host and executive producer, Eddie Robinson. Thanks so much for listening. And remember, I feel you. We hear you. I see you. Until next time.